All right, so it should be recording. So I'm gonna eat up my hard drive really quick.
Awesome.
Okay, so Planescape is the old school D&D multiverse, with some tweaks. The most of the action sort of takes place in Sigil, which is a city that is kind of on the inside of a torus, which floats at an infinitely at the top of an infinitely tall spire, in kind of in the middle of nowhere.
In the middle of everything, you mean?
Yes, yes. It may in fact be the center of the plains, although everybody is pretty sure that they may also be the actual center of all of existence. That's entirely possible. So the thing that makes this setting cool is that you can really sort of go anywhere. The planes are infinite, despite being sort of definite things in and of themselves. And all sorts of weird creatures live on them. So, you know, you might find demons in the abyss, and devils in the hells, and angels in Mount Celestia. And this is also where all the gods live. Like, they all have their kind of own little domains within their planes. In D&D, it would depend on their alignment. I'm not going to worry about alignment, aside from as sort of a conceptual, you know, law versus chaos and good versus evil, sort of thing. Okay. But the idea is that the farther out you radiate from the center, the more polarized everything gets. The thing that makes Sigil cool, is that it's number one, sort of a neutral zone. There are no gods that are allowed in the city. And there are, it's sometimes referred as the city of doors, sometimes referred to as the cage. Any opening that's bounded on all sides, if you have the proper key, can get you to somewhere else. It will turn into a portal. And the key can literally be anything. It could be a feather. It could be thinking a specific thought.
So even just like a regular door frame can be turned into a portal if you have the right key.
Yeah, or a window, or a, like, barrel hoop.
Really?
Yeah.
So yeah. Any opening.
Any opening. But it's not like there's a map of them, right? Like, it's kind of one of those things where people will stumble on it. And sometimes that information can be discovered, and sometimes people accidentally run into them and they only go one way.
Oops.
And that one rays into the flaming fires of the lava lake on the whatever level of Baytor.
Right, right.
Or you're playing croquet with flamingos.
While all the gods live kind of out on the plains, in different places, depending on you know, where they fall on the axis of law and chaos and good and evil. Sigil itself is ruled by one woman, the Lady of Pain, who never speaks, and for the most part, just kind of, like, she's not seen very often, but when she is, it's usually a big deal, and sometimes fatal for people. She's just kind of this weird, implacable, impassive figure. But when she is displeased, like, and her shadow falls over people, they wind up getting rended by millions of invisible blades. And some people, if death isn't good enough for them, or is too good for them, she'll instead banish them into, like, she has the ability to create, like, these little maze pocket dimensions, mm-hmm. and send people in there where they'll never find their way out. So for this game, the reason that I came up with such a sort of strong pitch is because it's so open and it's so easy to get lost, and I didn't feel like running four different games with everybody running around like freaks in various different planes.
I get you.
So I thought having something central to grab onto would be a good idea. But Sam's idea of trying to find his kidnapped wife, that's been stolen and dragged through a portal back to the plains, I found to be somewhat inspiring. That's damning with faint praise. That's not how I meant that to come out. I thought having a group of people that I could look at and be like, you know what I see when you guys, I look at you guys? Losers. I mean people who have lost stuff.
Lost.
might be kind of fun. So that's kind of where I was going with it. Your employer Marta has handed you in her old lover's journal, most of the pages of which have been removed, and asked you to go track them down. And you are the people that have lost other things on the plains, and her implied promise is that if you help her, she'll help you. And of course, there's a shit ton of setting material, like, and I don't expect everybody to have read it, which is totally fine. I think I linked everybody to the Dropbox that has my copy of the old D&D setting.
Yep.
Back on it. So that's there for your perusal, when you're interested, but I don't want you guys to be like, I don't remember any of this. There's a whole bunch of stuff. But I thought it was a good sort of starting point.
The first few chapters are a pretty good, like, flavor of what's going on.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think I don't think we need to, like, it's the infinite planes, right? And, like, even for people, characters that are coming from the prime material plane, which is kind of where all of the quote unquote normal people are from. You know, where they think that all of this is outside in the cosmos instead of living in the cosmos.
Mm-hmm.
Technically, we all live in the cosmos.
Yes, technically we all do, but it's the it's the difference between the, like, aliens that understand the vastness of the multiverse and the schlubby.
You want to make a cake? First, you have to make a cake from scratch. First, you have to make the multiverse.
That's right.
Making pretty cake?
It's yes.
You're cooking by the book.
It's a piece of cake to make a pretty cake, but first you have to invent the multiverse. Wow. Okay. We've just fucked everything up. It's gone. It's destroyed.
Pretty much, yeah.
Well, that was fun, guys.
It was yes. Nice times. Nice times. Anyway. I guess the real question is, is what do we need to fill in?
A really good reason that we're all going to be sticking together and not just
Well, yeah, that's kind of why I created a pitch.
What is our pitch for our characters in one sentence? I think that's a great place to start with a character thesis.
Okay, well, let me turn this to you. What have you lost? And like
that's what I'm trying to figure out for my guy.
Mine's loaded already.
Was
looking for his wife.
This is why I always get frustrated when we jump the gun on character creations. Because I always feel like the character should come out of the situation rather than here's a bunch of characters, let's figure out a situation to fit them all into.
Yeah. Right. It's a little hectic.
Yeah.
I think we've all been in games that shit the bed because of that.
Yeah. I think so like what kind of characters would already be predisposed to doing this, right? Like I think it's safe to assume that you guys know each other. Like there's no meeting at the bar. This case, or if you did, it happened a long time before now.
Yeah, we're not new to each other right now.
You know, are you people that have like found your way here to Sigil for whatever reason, and now, you know, are like just kind of making a living, and this was a promise of adventure and or employment.
This sounds like a perfect time for us to introduce our characters to each other because I don't know who everyone is.
Yes, exactly. Yeah,
so, Glover, you want to go first?
Well, it is still fluid because, I mean, you know, I might change ideas later based on what we've come up with for everything else. But right now, I've got a tiefling spell sword mercenary. He's a wizard fighter. He's sells himself out for hire. He was the offspring of some backwater primordial playing noble family, thinking they could make themselves more powerful by doing a pact with a demon. And the demon just kind of used them as breeding stock to create Gregor, who he wanted to become a commander in the blood wars.
Blood war.
Gregor kind of just wants to stay away from all that. In fact, one of the things I was debating is to try to flip it around, and instead of being found, Gregor wants to find a better way to get lost from his father.
Yeah. Okay.
I like that.
Sweet. So what you want to find is safety?
Possibly. It's all. I haven't really thought it through all my beliefs yet because I want to see where everyone else goes first. But yeah,
that's totally fine. What about Freddy? You, Freddy?
Okay, so I am Lahiris. She is a elven bard, kind of a healing bard. More likely to run away from conflicts or try to hide than fight. You know, she has a knife, but she would rather heal afterwards or, you know, support other people. She got here with a song that she got in a dream and sang it, and that opened up a gate. And being curious, she stepped through and she doesn't know how to get back. And so she's literally lost everything and she's trying to get home.
Nice. Is she from a prime material plane or from elsewhere?
Yeah, she's from, where did I say she's from?
Toril.
Toril, yeah.
Okay.
Forgotten Realms.
Yep.
Yeah, Forgotten Realms, Toril. So she's basically betrothed and she just is like gone from there, and she's trying to find her way back, and she's trying not to despair because she can't find her way home, and she can't go into the West if she doesn't find the gate back home.
Awesome.
But her whole deal is like she's trying to like have a sunny disposition, like heal people, be the bright spot in someone's day, and just kind of be the center of attention. And she also likes to get her hands in everything, and she has one particular person who's really angry with her. What's his name? Baron Amon, who he's the owner of Orbs and Talismans, and I accidentally broke his prized crystal unicorn, and I may have taken his sextant. So
nice.
Ooh, it's great.
I see that you took Atrovieso.
Uh huh.
That's
yeah.
Were you disappointed when you found out the sextant wasn't what you thought it was?
Yeah, when I was in like ninth grade. And then I looked it up in a book.
And you're like, oh, that's some burn cream to that. So much more, so much less interesting.
Yeah.
Sextant was a navigation tool?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, that's what I thought.
So, yeah, I just, that's me. I've lost everything and I'm trying to get it back.
All right.
My character is a overly polite rogue, born an urchin, but ended up becoming a servant in a noble court of some sort. So I'm thinking my character might actually be from Sigil.
Okay, so you're a local?
Yeah.
Nice.
I don't know.
Does Sigil have like even just a mockery of the noble court kind of situation?
That's a good question. It's kind of ruled over by one person, and she's not exactly a queen. Or
she doesn't believe in the cult of personality thing, huh?
Yeah. In fact, she once people tried to worship her, and she utterly destroyed their temple, like exploded it literally and murdered everybody.
Yeah.
Which is fine, because there are plenty of places on the plains that may have had like their own like noble courts and whatnot. Or you could have been a noble court on a material plane somewhere. Like that's totally fine. There's just not really one locally.
Oh, okay.
If that makes sense, like. Yeah, I just mean we can make it work. It'll just have to work as kind of the last thing that you were doing, before you wound back up in Sigil.
Right. Oh, I guess I could be originally been from Sigil and then
moved away around
to be a servant and then came back.
Yeah.
I just kind of wanted, you know, maybe to have one local person for Bina.
Yeah, three primes and a planer.
Yep.
Three primes and a little. Yeah, that's
okay. So in that case, then I guess I would have been the urchin and pickpocket in Sigil, and then made some connection to some traveler coming by, made an impression on them, became their servant, and then a servant in noble courts on someone to play.
What's your character's name?
That's a good question. I never named my characters until the last minute. Something androgynous, because that's kind of my, oh yeah, it's an overly polite rogue who's completely androgynous.
Okay.
So, androgynous and plain, but not, so there's something beautiful, but it's not something that stands out that people would remember.
Right.
It's not a rememberable beauty.
Okay.
You have plain faced.
It's yeah.
Good trait.
I have a lot of traits with this life path. It's kind of crazy. Because I have one diet trait, which is sickly, which
sucks. Great.
Yeah, decidedly but not good.
Four call-ons.
Oh, damn.
I have fleet of foot, lifting heavy things, mind-numbing work, and unheeded, which is a call-on for inconspicuous.
Nice.
So, you know, mind-numbing work, probably not that big a deal. Lifting heavy things, meh, but the other two are pretty.
Yeah. Lifting heavy things can be a good call-on.
Yeah, it can. It's just very specific.
Yep, it is.
And I love that the one of the character traits is veneer of obedience.
You fake it really well.
Right.
I do. And that's kind of the whole thing around the character is that, you know, if picking a pocket and found out, be like, oh, you dropped this, sir, and like start a conversation and just kind of glaze over the whole thing. And, so.
Cool. Well, you don't have to pick a name right now because we're just kind of doing the initial setup stuff.
Yeah. Always do that last.
Yep. Cool. So Sam.
So Sensei Katsuo Matsumura is a samurai.
Who just
happens to be a bipedal gray-crowned crane.
Okay.
The Birdman Samurai, in one sentence, to summarize him. His drive is that his wife has been taken through a portal into the plains by a creature he can only describe as an Oni, a nightmare demon creature from his culture's stories. And so when this happened, he was a samurai of some renown, so he gathered all that he kind of could and has left on a journey to find her again. And that's all I've kind of built for personality wise. I left all of my traits and all of my beliefs and instincts open because I wanted Katsuo to be, for the most part, dependent on other characters to help him get around. He, like, obviously being a birdman, he can fly, but he's from a vastly different culture. Like Matt, you mentioned that Lyris is from Toril, from Forgotten Realms. Mm-hmm. I like that Katsuo is from like another world that's out there in the prime, but is like anthropomorphic, like it's all animal bipeds, it's all animal people.
That's
and it just
cool.
happens to be a bird.
Yeah, totally.
So a devil or an Oni or a devil you say took your wife, and a devil or an Oni or a devil you say was my father.
Yeah, I love that connection. In fact, my second belief right now states thing about
something
the
about Felcrest. I saw that. Yeah,
that's all it says. Thing about the Felcrest dude.
So nice.
I figure we'll figure that out. I'm not fully burned up. I've burned life paths, skills, and I've started to burn resources to get him his stuff that makes him a samurai, right? So he's got his sword, he's got his bow and his armor, and he's probably got a memento from his missus.
Right.
But I left all of the other resource stuff open, and one of the things I guess I'm really curious about is how are resources and property going to work in a game in which we aren't based in our home? Does that represent stuff we own in Sigil?
That is a good question. So, not necessarily. Lands, titles, all of that sort of thing are somewhat problematic. But all of you all primes get a fun trait for free called Clueless.
Which adds the ob of all circles
which,
and resource tests. So which that could represent the...
Yeah, and that was that's the intent there. Just, you know, I think the idea is that you know, the people who live on the plains kind of know what's up. I imagine that in Mass Effect 3, people who lived on the Citadel knew what was up, and then the Earthlings showed up, and it took a while to adjust. And that's kind of the same feeling that I get, like, you know, one prime or another, like one prime plane or another could be found with enough research, right? Like, mm-hmm. there's stuff that could be leveraged. Somebody just has to know, like what it is, that. Like how to get to where you're from, right? Obviously, stuff that you know you can carry with you. Some of it might be that you've managed to eke out your own little bit of you know place on in Sigil or maybe down in the Outlands. Because it's probably the closest thing to a prime material plane that you find out here. I guess it's up to you for flavor as to how you want that to work. And we can work on it. Like we'll just kind of play it by ear, and we'll.
I kind of like the idea that. My character's been stuck in Sigil for like almost 30 years and she's been wandering around, but she makes her living like singing at taverns.
and there are plenty of those.
Yeah, yeah. And being an elf, she causes wonderment every time she sings. And so she gets a lot of tips.
Yeah, and yeah, that's kind of one of those things. It, like, some characters that, like, you might not be able to afford lands and that kind of stuff. If you can, we'll just have to see how we can work it into the fiction, appropriately. Or maybe we need to tweak. You know, there's going to be a lot of traits going around. Because, I mean, let's face it, Birdman needs a whole bunch of traits.
And that's, honestly, I have that worked up.
Tiefling.
However, I do want to bounce two off you.
Okay.
So the first four are fairly straightforward. Wings, feathered, beak, and talons.
What kind of wings? I think there are specific wing traits in the Monster Birder.
And that's where I'd kind of talked with you, Shaun, about how to do wings. And the way that I'd kind of seen is doing it is that he can use his, like, hands. Kind of like, you know how Donald Duck has wings, but he uses them like hands?
Right.
It's like that. Like, he can hold a sword or a sword and a shield and do stuff with his hands, but he has to have them free to fly.
Right. Yeah, I think that's totally fine.
And I think if he takes a two-die wound to an arm, he can only glide to the ground.
Right. Yeah. That's totally fine. I was just gonna say there is a trait called wings.
Oh no, yeah, I might ignore it.
I may have grabbed these right out of the book.
It's a 6-point die trait. This creature bears wings similar to a bird and may fly via them. It requires 3 actions to take flight. Speed multiplier is times 14, but that we will, of course, tweak because converted, speed multiplier is not a thing.
Yeah.
Converting a stride now.
Yeah.
The other two traits I had that I wanted to bring to the group and see what they thought. The next is low speech birds.
So you can talk to birds?
Yeah, it speaks bird talk.
Is that something you see the anthropomorphic creatures in your world having, is the ability to talk to the creature that they are kind of from?
I think it makes sense that, you know, maybe you can talk to a sparrow or some type of small bird, and it's maybe not perfect. Like, I can understand there being issue, like general, like nouns and verbs would make sense.
Or maybe some of the smarter birds, like ravens?
Yeah, that follows.
It could be, like, limited to the more intelligent birds, because, like, sparrows might just be the dumbasses of the bird world.
I was going to say, it's a 3-point die trait. Choose one type of animalia. Birds, horses, and beasts of burden. Beasts of the wild, reptiles, and scaly beasts.
You just can talk to all birds, and that's fine.
And that's totally fine.
Okay, the next one I am skeptical about, but I'll see what the group thinks. It's in the Monster Burner. It's third eye.
Yeah, I saw that.
Which is?
It has a third eye. Like, the critter has a third eye on its brow. It's not just an eye. It's a sign of enlightenment and insight. Through it, the monster gains access to the sorceress incantation, Mage Sense. Each time
basically, it's like you can see auras and stuff when he opens it up, right?
I'm familiar with Mage Sense, yeah.
It allows you to use, like, in gold, it is crazy powerful.
Yeah.
It's an OB4, and it, like, lets you see magic and where it's from, and, like, all I'm looking for is something that gives him an ability to be on the planes and not just get destroyed by something with magic. Like, he can see it and go, oh, that's magical. I should probably not dick with that.
It seems a little bit over. I mean, dude, you can already fly.
That is true.
You know, you don't need detect magic for free. I think that there's enough, like, it's not like people just leave random magical shit lying around, right? Like, and if you're in the city, it functions like a normal city. I mean, yeah, there's the weird, you know, race of builders that only speak in rebuses, but
I don't know what rebuses are.
Those are the pictogram puzzles.
Oh, really?
Yeah, where it'll be like, I heart you, or that sort of thing. Yeah, when they speak, it just kind of appears.
So they speak in pre-internet emoji?
Pretty much. Pretty much. That is almost exactly...
So they're Q-Bert.
Yeah, kind of.
Symbols and noises. And you're like, that doesn't make any sense. Okay, Q-Bert, I guess I'm going to move you around these blocks. Okay, so I'll delete third eye. And I'll have low speech birds, and then talons. I don't know. Talons allow him to, like, claw people with his feet, and beak. I think there's pecking,
which all makes sense.
Yeah.
You know, which I think I just kind of looked at what a giant eagle had and scaled it back.
Yeah. Well, it's the idea is that we figure out, like, what do you need to meet your concept and no more, right? Like, that's. That's kind of where I think the direction we need to go. I think we need to come up with also some traits to sort of represent where you guys are from. Probably character traits.
Yes.
To add on. I mean... Everybody but Haley gets Clueless for free. Which already puts the non-natives at a disadvantage, but that's kind of the way it works. I thought that there was...
I mean, just so yeah, simply being there, like, we're at a disadvantage, really.
Haley?
Yeah.
So there's a downside to being born on the plains.
Okay.
And the downside is that when people summon things, this is where they come from.
You can be summoned.
Yeah, normally people, like, they try and summon demons or angels,
yeah,
or like a deceased loved one that's, you know,
indigenous servants, you know.
Well, you know. So
I'm always looking for one of them.
So every planar has the named trait.
Okay.
It's a die trait, and basically all it means is that you are sort of cosmically linked to your name, or to your true name, which may not be the name that you go by. In fact, I imagine that there's an awful lot of creatures that don't go by their true names and keep those hidden.
My true name is Bob.
Bob. But yes, for this reason...
All right. If that's the case, I want to run my traits by you guys to see if they meet my requirement for what I want to play.
Okay.
I'm a tiefling. The first thing I picked out right off the bat was resistant to fire. Makes sense. They're supposed to live in the fiery pits and hells. Mm-hmm. They're mostly cosmetic, but they are technically die traits, and he took claws and fangs.
Okay.
Now, he doesn't really fight with him, but, you know, I mean, that's he's got sharpened nails and pointy teeth.
Right.
And then horns.
Okay.
Which I didn't realize count as head armor.
Yes.
Kind of neat.
Well, and claws and fangs, actually... you can use in combat
as weapons.
Yeah.
Yep. But if it allows me, if I want, when I use the charge action, to also throw a strike action in with it.
Nice.
If I head go in head first, which I don't think he will too much, but do you guys think those are all pretty reasonable? Claws, fangs, resistant to fire, and horns.
Yeah, I think that sounds very tiefling.
Oh, and a character trait, demonic visage, just because there's got to be something there that, you know, for looks. And he's got the red skin and the you know, the hellish eyes or whatever. So.
Nice, yeah.
I have a question about... Yeah. Call on traits?
Yes.
They say, you know, they give a couple of skills that it's a call on trait. So when it says pick one, you have to pick one like as you burn the character?
Yes. Yes. Call on traits generally only work for very specific things. Which call on is it?
Charming.
Okay. And it lets you pick
between soothing platitudes or seduction.
Nice. Yeah, so...
I'm trying to... Because, like, I'm also, you know, basically this tall, fair-haired, like, beautiful elf woman. Like, how should I play this? I'm just like...
That is a good point.
Fun?
Do you see her more as a seductress, or...
I think I see more the soothing platitudes.
That's kind of what I get. I don't see you being like getting what you want by trying to bed people.
Like I do have like one of my skills is seduction.
Right.
But it's not very high skill, but it's there just
right.
In case I gotta use it because it works well at the bar. You know, to get tips.
Yeah. I mean, it's just the perceived promise of
business
time. Exactly.
Absolutely. Like that and, you know, Atravieso works pretty well together. You can just put my hands all over them and just grab shit, you know?
Yep.
And then fair and statuesque and born under the silver stars, I'm basically like, everybody likes me.
Firstborn.
Yep. Yeah. Firstborn. Let me see. Conspicuous.
You are definitely conspicuous.
Yes. I am basically the opposite of Haley.
You distract them. I sneak up behind them and kick them.
That's kind of like, I'm like, that could actually work really well. I'd be like, hey, look at me. And everyone just stabs them. Yay. Pay attention to me, not the bird person.
Oops. Yeah, screw that bird guy.
Yeah, that bird person, not even pay attentionable. I'm like, I'm pretty lady.
Whatever. There's a snake bodied lady over there with four arms.
Yeah. Dime a dozen.
It's the downside of everything existing. That everything exists.
Yeah. There's always someone more conspicuous than you.
This is true.
Yep.
This is true.
I'm looking forward to being able to use Doom of Strength.
You weaken your foes.
Let me see. No, the soother will sing Doom of Strength to revitalize the wounded and send them back into the fray.
Oh, nice.
They ignore wound penalties, right? But they don't actually cure the wounds.
If successful, the song temporarily reduces the target victim's wounded dice by the margin of success.
That's awesome. No, get back out there. You can do it, champ. I don't care that you're bleeding.
The effect lasts for minutes equal to the health of the recipient. So it doesn't last too long, but yeah, just get out there and stab because we need you to stab.
All right, so looking at this, we need a belief about something that's you want to find.
Yep.
A belief about another character and an open belief.
Yeah. The bit about good and evil, law versus chaos, I wasn't sure what you guys were wanted to do there. So that was just an idea that popped into my head. You know, that third belief can seriously be anything that you want.
I'm thinking about making a belief about my enchanting. I don't know yet, though.
Enchantment.
Enchantment. Hey, Haley, I think I'm going to make a belief about your character. I'm just not sure what.
Okay.
Because you just seem so sad and sickly, and I'm like, I could make you better.
You're one of those who just wants to fix them all, aren't
you? Yes. Right. Yes.
Do I want to be weirdly entranced with the Elvish Bard? Is that what this is?
If you wanna, I'm good at entrancing people.
We could get into a pretty heavy roleplay.
And I have a question about wonderment.
Yes.
Whenever I sing one of the spell songs, pretty much anyone who's not an elf is subject to wonderment, which basically they have to roll steel.
Yes, it forces a steel test.
And if they fail, they have to stand and drool.
Yep.
Or can they weep? Oh, no, that's the spite
version. Yeah, that's spite.
You could weep with joy. I don't know. I mean,
But if your question is that your friends too? Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, hell yeah. Okay, that'll be fun.
Okay, where the hell are they?
Let's see what other shitty things can I do with my singing.
By the way.
What's that?
Have you burned your character up and gotten your grief yet?
Yes, more or less.
I imagine you get a pretty significant bump for being on an entirely different world than your love and being locked away from all your people.
Doesn't help. I have a grief of 5.
Ooh.
Let's see. Wonderment takes effect in a number of exchanges equal to the target's will.
I guess it doesn't say what options are. You could fall to your knees and beg for mercy, I suppose.
Yeah, you could run screaming. I can imagine there's
Jesus.
Well, like, just like the beauty of it reminds you of such dark stuff in your own life. You're like, I can't take it. I gotta get away from this prettiness.
Yeah, or if it's something like Song of Burning Bright.
Oh, goddamn.
You come down literally wreathed in flames.
Song of Burning Bright, yeah. Evokes a true fire within the elven heart. So it only works on elves.
Right.
But the wonderment doesn't. The wonderment works on everybody. As you sit there and you catch on fucking fire. And if anyone hasn't yet, and you guys really want to get a really cool visual representation of how all work, look up somewhere. It's on the forums that Luke wrote up, and it was when elves go to war.
Yeah, it's pretty freaking badass.
Cool.
There's another good one about when elves die.
Yeah.
And what an elven funeral is like.
Because the death of an elven scholar isn't just like the death of a dude. It's like, oh god, an entire library is now gone. An entire source of knowledge is gone forever.
Yep.
I also have Song of Merriment, so I can just make you all super fucking happy.
Do you have any laments?
Yes. You gotta have a fucking lament.
Gotta have a lament.
Let me see. Which lament do I have?
A lament to Gandalf.
Hmm.
Sorry. I was just thinking today that it's really weird that I don't own the Lord of the Rings soundtrack, because that shit is really good.
It's really good. I have it. It's awesome. I have Lament of Stars. Let me see. This lament obeys. Let me see.
All the laments work the same.
Yeah. As they left their ancestral homeland and crossed the sea to their new home, the bards composed this song to ease their heart pain and homesickness.
That's pretty awesome, because there are no stars in Sigil.
Yep.
Oh, shit. Oh, shit.
Yeah.
That's
you're gonna have to be looking at like old navigation maps from your prime material played. Like,
I'll be poking holes in a
black paper
sheet or something. Like that. Star.
This is what they look like.
I haven't seen the stars for 3 decades. That's how horrible it is.
Up your grief up right now, young man.
Jesus.
Okay, so I figured out what I'm looking for now.
Okay.
So I figure my family has been serving either some guy or some family. Can work out the details later. For generations. For ages, but when I was young, the master disappeared. So I'm looking for the master.
Hmm.
The master would not approve.
How do you know? So I didn't want to do it about another like love interest or something again or something like.
I'm looking for my betrothed. Which is where everything else is that I care about.
Did you take the really broken elf trait, Unbreakable?
Is that the one where it makes it harder for you to succumb to grief?
It makes it literally impossible to succumb to grief, because all your grief tests are like at -1 ob. So an ob 10 grief test is, you never get an ob 10 grief test. They're always at least 9.
Oh, wow.
Unless it's...
No, because even Luke was like, yeah, that makes the elf will never succumb to grief.
Oh, holy crap.
Yep.
Which is why it's called Unbreakable.
Yep.
I did not take that.
Also, your elf ends up looking like, what's his face?
Elrond?
No, what's his, Lee Pace's guy.
Oh, Jesus, what was his name?
And ends in an L.
Thranduil. Yeah.
There it is.
Both of you are incorrect. I was making an Unbreakable the movie quote, and I can't think of the name for some reason.
Thranduil.
Bruce Willis. Why the hell did I forget Bruce Willis? The name Bruce fucking Willis.
I'm sorry. I can't hear you over the sound of the face that he makes in that movie. That's so ridiculous. I have to do this face so I can show you. Oh, man. I honestly, I'm a little tempted to pick up the character trait taste for man flesh.
That
brains are predatory birds.
That seems really weird.
Might be a little awkward.
Sam, it's getting weird.
How to serve mankind. Oh, that's nice. He's here to help us. No, that's not what that means.
I guess I'll just go with turgid instead.
Turgid. Why you get
discernibly turgid?
Gotta make it weird.
Turgid. Oh.
Always gotta make it weird.
Is that really it? Is that really one?
Turgid? Yeah, it's in there.
Yep.
It's in
the book. Yep. I saw turgid and like.
I think I'm just gonna go with watchful.
As a character. Watching for turgidity.
Yeah.
Turgidity.
Oh my goodness.
So Shaun, about the trait sworn homage.
Sworn homage.
So I have that because in order to get to samurai, I figured knight
was
the proper life path to take. I think about that.
May it be a trait? Oh, go ahead.
I think about that with respect to a samurai, and it makes sense.
Yeah.
But do we really want to involve bird, like bird daimyo stuff in this story?
It might end up getting voted. You might have to take it now and just have it get voted off later.
Yeah. Yeah. Or it might come up at some point later, but.
Oh, that'd be so great. I love using that whole samurai culture in stories. I've read a couple of FMR campaigns, and I just want somehow Shaun to have his lord be like, "You must commit honorable seppuku," and then you'd be like, "Shit, well, do I help my friends and find my wife, or do I kill myself because my lord told me to?" Fuck.
Nah, that's a pretty easy choice. Considering.
Yeah, like I'm looking at it, and I don't think it's problematic. Like. The fact that you have sworn yourself to a master, I mean, that is part of what makes samurai samurai. The fact that you are separated from your master, you know, kind of notwithstanding.
Plus, doesn't it give you a belief?
No. It does not give you a belief, although it does encourage you to write one about it and gives you a one die affiliation with nobility.
Yeah.
With your clan or your.
Yes.
Your daimyo. Yeah.
Yeah. Which compounds with things like market privilege. So if you have market privilege, you now get a two die affiliation with your noble family.
Which I do. And I'm just going to call it nobility of Nihon. As a general catch-all, because the planes are freaking huge, and I don't know that anybody cares about Bird World.
I would love to see that movie, Bird World.
Bird World. Where humans come in and it becomes the humans, and the humans are just attacking the birds.
Humans are standing on these ropes.
I like that you just named your where you're from, Japan.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I distinctly heard him rename it Bird World. It is now officially
Bird World.
I'm sorry, Sam. I can't hear you over how good Bird World is.
So I hear you from Bird World. it's a lot of birds there.
You realize when you hand someone a feather, that's the equivalent of handing someone a finger in my world.
Wow.
You ass.
Or at least some pieces of hair, which is still just creepy anyway.
Yeah, I think it would be more like a cut of hair for one feather.
Sounds about right.
Sam.
You have too many Bird World problems.
Jesus Christ. Oh my God.
That is your one. Yes.
Bird World, Carl.
God damn it.
That's your what? Shit, I've used it up already.
That's gotta be Third World Blues has got to be the name of session one.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, God damn it.
Oh, God.
Wow.
Okay. So let's think of this. So for all of y'all that are not locals, let's talk about what, like, your what sort of cultural traits you should be picking between.
I imagine his little backwater prime material world is kind of just because it fits with the horror trope of hell and all that. It's kind of an Eastern European Russian kind of you know, the aristocracy had their dark castles up in the mountains, and the peasants live down below and live in fear and close their doors at night. And...
Yeah, like Romania.
Right.
Yeah.
Transylvania.
Yeah.
Okay.
I will take whatever you character traits you think are appropriate for that. I've already got a couple that fit with nobility. I've got arrogant.
Right.
I've got spooky. I've got demonic visage.
Okay. And that all totally makes sense. I'm trying to think of things that would make, like, I mean, that those things make your character uniquely your character.
I'm trying to think of something that makes me, hey, he's a guy from there.
Yes. And that's, if you had been a peasant, I would say something like fearful, or like fearful of dark things or something along those lines. But you are the dark thing that they are fearful of, or at least one of them.
So feared.
You're arrogant, and spooky, and those, you know, those count for some things. But is there anything that defines sort of the culture you are from?
That's what I'm trying to think, you know. I mean,
haughty.
That's kind of, I don't know, it's kind of arrogant. I don't know, haughty has got more of an air to it too, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. I mean, arrogant is one thing, but like, yeah,
airs of aristocracy, aristocratic.
Yeah, aristocratic would be fine. Old world aristocracy, or old world aristocrat. I mean, that.
I mean, he's trying to escape it, so this is something he's going to probably play against and get voted off pretty quickly. But yeah, that fits.
Old world values.
Old world aristocratic values.
Yeah, that's a little broad, I think. Maybe something about how you see your underlings.
High That's breeding. What I was thinking. Like, look, high breeding, mountain.
Ancient lineage.
Old blood.
I like ancient lineage.
Yeah, like your family has been around forever.
Ancient lineage. Nope, that's a misspell. All right. What's a good one that you look down on the peasants? I like, I don't know, I might put haughty. I like haughty.
I do kind of like haughty.
Okay.
I would stick with haughty.
And just drop ancient lineage?
Yeah. Yeah, I was just kind of trying to throw stuff out there.
I like it.
Arrogantly superior and disdainful.
Yeah.
Yeah, arrogant is just like, I know I'm the best. The arrogant trait is I know I'm the best. The haughty is like, I know I'm better than you, especially. You smelly, dirty peasants.
Exactly. take a freaking bath. Also, why am I in this city? Cool, that sounds good.
Cool.
What about you, Freddy?
Well,
so
I think I kind of covered a few of the traits already. I've got some elfy ones here.
You've got a lot of elfy ones. So with you, I was thinking because you specifically chose to be a character from Toril. Mm-hmm. It's been a while since I've really like dug into Forgotten Realms stuff. But is there any like Forgotten Realmsy like traits that elves?
Oh yeah, had? There's definitely one. I'd call it polytheistic.
Oh, nice. That's yeah. A good one.
Okay. They have their whole slew of gods.
Yes, and they all live
starting
up.
With Corathian, Lathion, or Lorella,
Corellian, Lareth.
I actually picked a couple that I like specifically.
Nice,
like the power, yeah, the lesser power of bards and minstrels, and the lesser power of healing are the ones that I kind of.
Sorry, I tracked down for the blog post for the D&D episode of We've Been Known to Be Wrong. I found this one that's, was it Keenan and Kel?
Dungeons and Dragons and Bitches?
No, it's Ghetto D&D, and like you see these guys like playing in an alley like they were shooting craps. Mm-hmm. And this like nerdy white dude comes in. And all these dudes are just like, yo, you think you can roll? Why don't you name all the elven gods?
Oh, dear.
And it doesn't quite get all of them. Dude's just like, man, dude forgot Elistray. It's ridiculous.
That's so good.
So would that just be a character trait, anything? Polytheistic?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you just play up that? I mean, and if it gets you in trouble, you get a fate point.
Yeah.
I have a feeling Hottie is going to be getting me in a lot of trouble.
I could totally.
Well, it's not even necessarily that it gets you in trouble. It's just that it moves play in a particular direction.
I thought it was specifically if it gets you in trouble.
No, that's instinct.
It makes the game awesome. So yeah. If the train makes the game fun, then something awesome happens.
Right. Okay. Cool. Yeah.
Coolio. Yeah,
but instincts are specifically when playing an instinct gets you into trouble.
Right. And yeah, basically all the LV stuff is really kind of that. And then, you know, I'm also charming because I'm a pretty bard.
Because you're a pretty singer.
Yep.
Songbird.
I actually do mostly it's singing and I play the flute. I have this like two-stemmed flute that I play.
Nice.
I've played with Shaun enough that give you a little pro tip, Matt. Don't sing in front of any dwarven kings. Just saying.
They might kidnap you. Try and put you in a cage.
They might kidnap you and call you a little songbird.
I think I remember this one. Yes.
Because they are jerk. Haley,
mm-hmm.
You're already a local.
I am.
I need to think of something for you, I think.
Is single kind of like New York, where it's like they've got immense pride for their own city and people outside the city, or they just kind of are jerks to?
Not really. There's lots of cities and settlements out on the plains. But I don't think, people from Sigil are like, we're better than anybody who's not from Sigil. Because that would probably piss some gods off. Mm. Even though gods aren't really allowed. I need to run upstairs really quick.
Okay.
Cool. So I will be back in just a moment.
We're still recording, by the way, so...
Yeah.
Well, I'm thinking something like, if you want to give me a treat, something like accepting just because there's so much going on in Sigil. I mean, anything can happen.
Like, welcome to the club.
Yeah, so people don't tend to snap to judgments as much, probably.
You've seen it all?
Yeah. Unimpressed.
Yeah, that could be a good one. Unimpressed is actually kind of cool trait. Maybe you are not moved by my song since you're like, yeah, heard it.
There is this guy this one time, but I think he did a little better.
So this seems like a little bit of a break time, so I'm going to step away as well, briefly.
Okay.
Those of you watching the show, we'll be right back. Oh, Sean's back, but hi, Sean. We're taking
a break,
just like you, so carry on.
What's up? Oh.
I'll be back. I'm just taking a quick break.
Okay.
So I was thinking unimpressed, because so much goes on in Sigil that it's just...
Yeah, you've just seen everything.
Yeah,
I can see that. Unimpressed. I think that sounds good.
Because seriously, come on.
What about the Birdman, Katsuo? So,
like one trait?
Yeah, or we can, like, if we need to, we can think up a couple, and you can pick what you think is the best one.
Hard.
Honorable.
Focus. Well, I guess that would be more.
I like that when it comes, like, decisive. Like, when it comes time to do the shit, you fucking do it. Like, once the choice has been made, there's no quibbling. It's, all right, this guy committed a crime. That crime, like, there's lots of evidence. It was brought before a tribunal. This person was convicted. The sentences chop a head off. When you're told, go chop the head off, you go up and you chop the head off.
Nice.
Like dutiful or decisive.
I think decisive sounds good.
Mm-hmm. Having or showing the ability to make decisions quickly or effectively is decisive.
Yeah. Like, you know what to do, or no, you know what you want to do, you do it. You're man of action. Bird of action. Action bird.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I'm pretty comfortable with what I've got there.
Cool.
And now you have your sitcom name.
Yeah.
Action bird.
Bird world problems.
Wow.
So on the character sheet, Sean, do we have to go in and add all of our skills onto the front page?
Well, it has the dots and
on the where it says stats and skills. Mm-hmm. And you just click the add button and yeah.
On information or on stats and skills?
On stats and skills.
Wow, that's gonna be tedious.
Yeah.
A little bit.
But you only have to do it once.
Yeah, that's good. Does it track tests?
Have you not seen how it works?
No.
All right, let me show you how this works.
The dots are a little weird, though.
So, wait, I have your. How do I get
there? So I see the dots and shit. What are we looking at?
Oh, I was gonna show Sam how the character sheets work. So let's say that you had to make an OB3 will test. So you go up to will, and you click the die.
Modifiers, I'm going to say 0.
Yep.
Arta, 0. Base obstacle, in this case, we'll say it's a 3.
Yep.
So it just says, I rolled, you got 4 successes.
You got 4 successes versus an versus a 3 obstacle. It calculates whether or not it's routine or difficult or challenging.
Oh, I see.
And then you just click the bubble, and it'll auto fill in like how many tests you need, but it won't automatically bump up when you fill in the requisite number of bubbles.
Why is there already one bubble filled in?
Because you will never need more than 4 or more than 3 tests.
Oh, got it.
Okay. But for layout, it is easier.
What if it's open-ended?
Then it will automatically, it should automatically do that.
Okay. I think.
Okay, I'll show you.
Oh, okay, so.
It's got the white top there. If it's open-ended, let me roll my sorcery. Oh, you got to click exactly on one of the black parts. You can't just click in the middle of the die.
Boo.
Oh, that's weird.
It's yellow if it's open-ended.
Yep. And there's a little box just to the right of the skill or stat. And if you click that, that makes it open-ended.
Ah, so
okay, so it's already
pre-populated. Yes.
Okay. Huh. So what are we thinking for like property? Because I'm thinking I've got enough resources, I might consider buying like a little house.
That's fine. Like whatever you want to do. We'll just have to figure out how to work it in. Like, what are you thinking, that it's back on your home plane, or is it something that you've like managed to purchase with what you had here?
I think it's something that he's managed to get here, that they have he has a place to call home, because Sigil is going to be the basis for the game.
Right. Yeah, I think that's totally fine. It's not like, I mean, it's crowded. I'm not sure if Sigil has limited space or unlimited space. It kind of grows and shrinks and changes as, you know, for in some ineffable way. So
is there a place on this sheet to put reputations?
Second sheet, stats and skills, reputations and affiliations under the attributes.
Oh, I see. Okay. Gotcha. I have a reputation as an unclean, meddling prime.
Excellent.
Because I accidentally touched someone who didn't want to be touched by a prime.
Oh, so it's an infamous rep. So it also increases your odd by 1, but gives you the bonus die.
Nice.
I have a reputation spell sword for hire. And then 2 affiliations, one with the Felcrest family that I got from my Lord Noble, and one from my Arcane Legion, which is the mercenary group I'm a part of. Same set of Sigil.
Cool.
Sean?
Yeah.
This is totally cheesy, but what if I want to find something that is beyond the scope of just beliefs, but if I write enough beliefs about things that kind of ties to it, what if, since he has no family, he wants to find a family of his own, and so his beliefs involve getting close and helping the other party characters to kind of make them his family.
Yeah, that's totally fine. As long as it's, I guess, sort of concrete things, if that makes sense.
Like, what if I had my beliefs be like, say I took all three of my beliefs, and all three of my beliefs were like, each one was focused on one of the characters about helping them, you know?
Yeah. You can do that.
Or even just one being kind of a fate kind of, I will offer any and all aid to my companions whenever I can.
Yeah, even the that's lowly totally fine. Servant? Even the lowly servant. Even though at least one of them is far, far below you.
You say haughty, and now I want to just roleplay my character as Charles Winchester. Charles Emerson Winchester III. Gentlemen. And ladies. Sorry, gentlemen and staff.
And staff.
Such a dick.
Sorry.
Okay, it's gonna be like how he was raised at first, but he's trying to fight that. He's trying to get over that. So
I think it makes sense to buy a powerful, not like really powerful, but like a 10-point hateful relationship with the mysterious Oni that stole my wife.
Do you have a relationship with them? Like, you go and you know them personally?
I think that they could be somehow connected.
Well, they could be connected, but that doesn't necessarily... A relationship implies that they are somebody that you know, right? Like, you could totally have a relationship with one in particular if you've been, like, maybe hunting it down on the plains, but there's also a certain amount of access that it gives you. So if your character is about hunting it down, I would make a belief about it, but probably wouldn't give you
a relationship.
Okay. See, my character has a relationship with his father, but he wants to get away from his father.
Yeah. Yeah, because the other, like, you know, the reciprocal is also true, that taking a relationship with somebody gives them a certain amount of access to you.
Basically, if you're the mechanically, if you ever want to find him, you never have to circle him up. But it still has to make sense in the fiction. So you can't be like, I go grab my father when you're in the plane of water. You can't be like, my dad's right over there, I'm gonna go find him, you know.
Right.
I can probably actually put his name down now. Samael. The Pit Fiend. Or maybe the Oni that took your wife is like a lieutenant for Samael and kind of leads us to a similar... What's the starting situation is we're going to immediately be going, are we going to be starting in Sigil or are we
you will
be
starting? You will be starting like inside the mortuary, or actually outside the mortuary.
Okay.
In Sigil, which is the home of the Dustmen.
Which are?
So Sigil is home to...
Put a link up to the book again. Maybe I could just read some. I mean, clearly that means I didn't get that Dropbox thing, I think.
Well, click on where your character sheet is. Under notes, okay. There should be campaign setup.
Yeah.
That's what he sent you.
No, I also, here, let me...
The Dropbox with some...
Hold on.
Sigil stuff or some...
Oh, the Sigil stuff. Oh, okay. Stuff. Okay, never mind.
Reputations are kind of weird in this game, I guess.
What?
You know,
what
local or...
No, it's
I mean, I guess it still makes sense.
The question is, how far does your reputation go?
Yeah.
How much does your reputation precede you? There's a link to that.
I just realized I don't have any city life paths, so I can't just talk to a normal person in Sigil with circles. I have an outcast life path, so I could talk to the underbelly of Sigil, but I can't talk to.
Just like the regular dudes.
I'm gonna buy a reputation as a noble, and then in like brackets, bird man. He's a noble man. He's a noble bird man.
Noble bird
man. You're a bird man.
And then affiliation. I'm gonna have a one die affiliation with a group called the Aviary, and it's a bunch of other kind of bird themed, like people. Like, it's just kind of like a group of people that talk that are all like birds of various feathers.
To all down in Bird Town.
It's not Bird World, but
it's like having a like a little China.
Yeah, it's like Chinatown, yeah. But it's
yeah, but it's the aviary.
But it's birds.
Can we buy a relationship with Marta?
I will.
Or is she kind of your sock puppet?
Yeah, she's kind of a sock puppet. I'll give you a minor relationship with her for free for everybody. Everybody kind of.
Okay.
Call me Mortuary Marta.
Well, she's not at the mortuary, is she?
No. No, she was in the hive, which is a it's like the lowest class part of Sigil. Where the poor and the dregs of society sort of conglomerate. And the city sort of takes on the characteristics of the people who live there. So it's just like ramshackle houses and like shit's falling down.
Question for you, Shaun.
Yes.
So affiliations, if I wanted to have like in a servant's affiliation, like an underground kind of network, would that be a 25 resource, large regional?
So it's, is it like a group that exists here? Like how, are you the boss? Or are you?
No, it would just be like a. You know, you see a guy on the street, you kind of know, okay, he's another servant too. Like, you talk differently to them. So, I mean, it's a large group, but it's,
I guess the question is, so with affiliations are with, like, specific groups of people. So, like, a noble family, like, a thieves' guild, like, people who are all, like, I don't know, other Freemasons.
So I'd have to be more organized.
Yeah. Yeah. It doesn't necessarily connote that they have like rank and hierarchy and that sort of thing.
Right.
But that they're all sort of members of the same club. They're actually in Sigil like sort of philosophers with clubs that are big deals. That can be represented with affiliations too. And there's quite a few of them, so I'm not gonna like. Oh, you know what I can do? I can do this right here. I'm gonna put this there.
Are we gonna have to
because that's gonna be the easiest thing to look up the factions. And this I think will take place before the faction war, because I don't know what that was or why it happened or what was going on, and I don't really care. So the original factions are the ones that are around. Those are more examples of things, and then, like, of course, other organizations exist within the city, because as long as it's not messing kind of with the status quo, Lady of Pain doesn't care. It's things aren't a problem until they're a problem, and that usually means that they're a big problem.
Doom Guard.
So we're not actually going into Mortuary. We're just using the key on the window outside and hopping through the portal it makes.
I believe it says on the inside.
Well, it just says inside. It doesn't explicitly say it has to be. I mean, you know, it says the word inside as its own sentence, but I construe that as you just hopping into it, like you're going towards the inside.
Oh no. Third window on the ground floor of the mortuary. You go inside.
Gee, I didn't.
Yep, that's what you meant.
I guess it inside. Me how I read. Okay. So the mortuary is, we're just going to hop. So we're going to have to get our way into mortuary.
Yes. And it's the mortuary. Like it is, it's not a city or anything. It's like, it's literally the mortuary where all the dead bodies in Sigil go. The different factions kind of have taken parts of the functioning of the city on their shoulders. And so they all kind of do their thing. They do their part. All the while trying to convince everybody that their way of viewing the multiverse is the correct way. Because if you get enough people to believe that that's the way things are, then that's the way things are.
Well, that is how the world works.
And in Sigil and on the plains, that's literally true.
So, reading up on these guys, do they think death is an illusion or life is an illusion?
They think that there is a. It's not that it's. Well, I guess they're sort of both. Illusions.
They think the only true death is when you just like don't care about anything and have no emotion about anything and this and that, and that's
yes, complete oblivion.
That, yes, or do they think that's something that should be avoided.
No, that is what they think that true existence is this state of oblivion, or nirvana, you know, this state of extending, or kind of existing beyond. The like pettiness of life and death.
So they just don't care about anything, right? That's what that means. So we can just walk in and they'll be cool because they don't care about anything.
They care about things. They have jobs to do. The you know, the living are okay when they're there to mourn the dead. Mortuary is all about them being being the keepers of the dead, although ultimately they think that everybody should be struggling to attain sort of the enlightenment that comes with the final death, true death.
Their true death, yeah.
Well, we'll find out next week, won't we?
True. They'll also have long-term contracts with people where because you don't really need it when you die. So they'll reanimate corpses and use them as labor.
Hmm.
So it's filled with like zombies and skeletons. The mortuary is. That are walking around doing things. Keep trying to click on things in the wrong window. It's not working.
So I suppose then, Shaun, you just kind of need from us like our whole, I guess, ideas about our character. And then...
Yeah, mostly your finalized beliefs. But I also want to know, is there anything beyond what we've kind of already talked about that you guys think needs to be addressed? You know, we don't have to go through the whole, like, Luke's list of questions, because most of them are answered by using sort of an existing world. We're just going to kind of kick it in the teeth as we go, like, beyond kind of what's established. I'm not engaging in any canon stuff, and I really don't know, like, what the canon of Planescape was beyond what came out in the original box set anyways. which is exactly how I like it. So is there anything going on in the city or on the plains that is sort of a backdrop against which?
Personally, I'd love to see stuff about the Blood War.
I think it's a given since you've already kind of built your character about the Blood War. What's going on with the Blood War? The Blood War is the devils of the plane of Beator, who are like the lawful evil, super evil bad guys, and the demons of the abyss have been locked in a feud for pretty much most of eternity over like what kind of evil is going to be like
which evil is the better evil.
Law or chaos. You know, and one is a highly regimented, very like rules bound, contract driven
fighting force. Yeah.
Yeah. The other has numbers and mass and madness and just freaking like throw
and
the
cunning.
Yes. And this war has been raging across the plains forever, and it tends to spill. If you look at the map on the actual table. Beator is over here, and the abyss is over here. Which is kind of funny because you can see where they are, even though they're technically infinitely large. But
they—that's where they are. That slice of the pie.
Yeah, but they have a tendency to for the war to spill across the plains in between them, and out into the outlands, which is sort of the epitome of neutrality. Like the closer you get into the center, the more balanced everything becomes, until you get to the spire where everything is perfectly balanced and magic ceases to exist. So the blood war is kind of a problem, but it's a problem that's been going on for literally forever. And neither of them have won, and neither side seems to be able to stop fighting.
Every now and then there are truces that are called, but they don't last long and the war starts right up again.
Yep. Pretty much immediately.
I got my first belief, though.
Oh, yeah?
This mission will place Fair Laharis in danger. By my wits and blades, I shall keep her safe.
Nice.
Or,
I gotta look at Lee Ev too. Lee. Spells, yes. Notes, and other miscellany. Everything's awesome when you're part of a team.
Everything is awesome. Part of a team.
God, do I want to try to do some like misguided attempt to like my fair lady her and be like, look, you are awesome and you can be pretty and great if let me just teach you because I know the best and let me teach you to thank you. The rain in Spain falls mainly on the plane.
Which plane? There's a lot of them.
No. It's the rain plane, Shaun.
The rain plane?
Yeah.
It's where air and water mix, isn't it?
I think that's the elemental plane of fog or steam. No, steam is where water and fire meet.
Does anybody have any interest in involving the Faded faction?
I like all the factions.
I was thinking about having a hateful relationship with someone named Leator of the Faded.
Yeah, that's awesome.
What are the Faded like?
they're objectivists.
Oh, Jesus.
And libertarians.
They take what they can from those who are unable to keep it, and I see them as dishonorable, like, dogs. And
by the way,
I tried to take something that someone had left, and I stepped in and said, no, you can't do that. And he said, yes, you can. And we got into a pissing match, and here we are.
Yeah, they serve as Sigil's tax collectors.
So if you can keep them at bay, then you deserve to not pay taxes.
Yeah, well, they're social Darwinists. I'm sorry, the Free League are closest to libertarians. What's the other? I'm trying to figure out. There was one that I guess it was them. That are basically objectivists. Yep. Nope. You're right. The Faded.
Yeah. Leator. Laator. Or is that confusing with Beator?
I always thought it was Beator, just like a long A. Beator. to Google to look it up.
I've always pronounced it Bay-a-tor.
Yeah, you would.
Is this something that we need to do online, or can we do this separately? I think I pretty much got mine done.
Yeah, really, I just, like, as far as the extra stuff, like, I just didn't know if anybody had any idea for, like, specific, like, a thing happened in the city, or...
Yeah.
And that's fine. If the answer is no, that's fine, and we can just start up next week and move along.
Between now and then, if I think of anything, I'll send it to you.
Yeah, and I'll kind of keep it in mind as well. Okay. You guys should all have access to the doc, so okay. Feel free to throw any ideas on there, and we can kibitz about it later.
Cool.
But next week we should be able to actually like start.
Yeah.
With
adventuring. My skills are done. I just burned all my resources. I may tweak one of my skills. I don't know if I want demonology and Oni-wise, but
I think no, those are two different skills. Yeah, other things that if you have like general points and want to take something suitably planescapey, things like planeswise or rule of three wise, because there's kind of a adage that things tend to happen in threes. Mm,
right.
or unity of rings wise, which also is kind of a things tend to form circles.
Okay.
I think I want to open those up.
Yeah.
All right, well, guys, I'm good, so I'm probably going to bounce and hit the sack.
Yeah.
Yep.
I'm also going to crash for now because I'm at a point where I don't think I can add anything to my character.
Yeah.
I will, but I just can't right now because of my brain not working.
So. I understand that. I have not recovered from Big Bad Con yet.
Oh, jeez. Poor you.
I'm still freaking wiped.
I just realized I don't have read or write. Fuck.
You were too busy with those combat-y things and learning spells and whatnot.
Time to change that shit.
All right. Good night, all.
Good night.
All right. Yeah, I think I'm going to.
All right.
I have an Elven script, so that's good. That basically means I can read and write Elvish, right?
Yes.
Okay. Good enough for me.
Sounds good. I'm going to go ahead and stop recording now.
Okay. Night, everybody.
Good night.
See ya.